Good afternoon, everyone. So, your computer, I don't think it's on your desktop or in your laptop bag or in your pocket, and I'm going to explain what I mean by that. So, you know how computers used to be these huge, big, hulking devices. The first Finnish computer was developed here in the 50s, just across the street. And to access computing, you basically had to belong to an organization. There were only a few computers per each country. And then the personal computing revolution happened, right? It became possible to produce mini computers and then microcomputers, and that put computers into everyone's desk and eventually into everyone's pocket. And the old mainframe faded into obscurity. In this picture from Google Ngram Viewer, it illustrates how the concept of a mainframe, a big central computer, sort of fades into obscurity, into hacker movies in which we have to hack the mainframe is still quoted, but not really in real life anymore. But in fact, I claim that the mainframe is now making a comeback. Only this time it's called cloud computing. So this red line shows the rising interest in something called cloud computing. So, you know, instead of running Office software on your own computer, instead of running Word on your computer, we're increasingly using Office 365. Or instead of this organization running its own email server, increasingly we are outsourcing email to Microsoft and Google. And even tax agencies are moving to the cloud. So the UK tax agency, I asked them how are they hosting their digital services. They said, oh, we're all completely based on Amazon Web Services, which is the leading cloud provider. The Finnish tax agency's digital service is based on Microsoft Azure, another cloud service. And I think that this is a reverse personal computing revolution. And that's because cloud is really a misnomer, because cloud suggests that computation is somehow diffusing into the atmosphere. But actually what's happening is that cloud computing means the concentration, the centralization of computation into very large industrial facilities, such as this Microsoft Azure hyperscale data center in North Holland. And insofar as the personal computing revolution was seen as this sort of a liberating force that enabled anyone in their garages to do a software innovation without asking anyone, and it had politically liberating effects as anyone could analyze data and anyone could sort of challenge the authorities, and without, there were no gatekeepers. Now, with the kind of reverse personal computing, computation is moving back inside closed doors. And the device that you have on your desktop or in your laptop bag or in your pocket, I don't think that's a computer really anymore in many cases. In many cases, that's just a terminal that you're using to access the actual computer where the software is running and where the data is being stored. And so the actual computer is in somewhere like this. And why is this happening? So why is computation now centralizing and concentrating into these large industrial facilities? Well, one reason is operational efficiency. It's much more efficient to run one very large facility like this than thousands of small on-premises data centers or smaller data centers. It's also more capital efficient. So the reason tax authorities love cloud or love this kind of mass computation, as I call it, is that if you're like me, you kind of file taxes pretty much just before the deadline. And that means so many people are like that, that actually most of the year, the tax agency's digital systems lie pretty idle. And then just before the deadline, suddenly the whole country goes on the tax agency's system and wants to file their taxes. And that means that their load across the year is extremely uneven, is very peaky. And now if they had to maintain themselves, the infrastructure on premises in their basements to support this peak capacity, that means that most of the year all this hardware would be unused. And that would be very capital inefficient. But by putting their workloads in large shared infrastructures like this, and then different organizations' peaks happening at different times, you're actually able to reach a much higher average utilization rate for the same infrastructure, for the same hardware. And that's more efficient, saves money for everyone. Another reason is energy efficiency. The International Energy Agency has been following the energy consumption of data centers for a long time now, because they've been very worried that as internet usage and computation increases, the sort of climate impact of computation and data centers would become worse and worse. But they reported just a few years ago that over the past 10 years, while the number of internet users has doubled, the amount of data, according to their estimate, circulating on the internet has grown 20-fold, yet data center energy consumption, curiously, has grown only moderately. The explosion that they feared and expected didn't happen. And they attribute this largely to the shift from small, energy-inefficient on-premises computation to these large industrial facilities, which are able to use industrial techniques to achieve higher energy efficiency and which are able to recycle the waste heat in municipal heating systems or industrial processes, which is not possible if you just run one server in your basement. So all these sort of economic and environmental factors are changing the geography of computation. They are causing this kind of diffused model where all the computation happened everywhere across society. It's kind of pushing it into these certain discrete, very large sites. In fact, one IBM research study suggested that in the future it might be enough to have just one really big computer where all of the world's computation is done. So, of course, this kind of concentration carries with it certain risks as well. So in my group, we started to try to sort of map where is computation going? You know, if the computational universe is collapsing on itself, where is it collapsing? And these are the locations of the infrastructure belonging to six major hyperscale cloud providers that represent something like 75% of the global infrastructure as a service and global platforms as a service market. And there's many things you can observe here, but perhaps the most striking one is that most of the world's countries don't actually have any of this infrastructure. So we have a lot in Europe, there's a lot in US, in China, in Southeast Asia, South Asia as well. But then there's many countries, including in many European countries, that don't have any of this infrastructure on their own soil. And for them, the shift to cloud means a shift to computation as an import service. Like we buy other things from other countries and we import them. In the same way in the future, or even in the present today, computation is an import that we bring. We no longer produce ourselves. We import into the country in many cases. And of course, then, during the pandemic, we had these issues with global supply chains breaking down and some imports that were shipped over in large ships not reaching us anymore, and that kind of disrupted society in many ways. So in the same way, if computation becomes an import product, we have to start worrying about supply security for computation. If, for instance, cables get cut and where our taxes and our emails are reliant on computation that's been imported, and that becomes a problem. Another thing that's interesting is that computation is concentrating not just on the geographic level, not just into these large industrial facilities, but also on an ownership level. So the vast majority of the infrastructure as a service market globally is being served by just three US cloud providers: Amazon Web Services, Microsoft Azure, and Google Cloud. And much of the remaining 30% is served by three Chinese cloud providers. And we've mapped their infrastructure here. And what's interesting about this ownership concentration and the fact that the leading players come from these two countries is that at the same time we live in a time in which geopolitical tensions are increasing. And even though these services are provided by commercial firms that are happy to serve all kinds of customers, we know from past events that the home governments of these companies have on occasion attempted to, the term that is used by political scientists, is weaponize the infrastructures of their companies to accomplish national security or foreign policy aims, such as espionage. And so it's whose cloud infrastructure you use, who owns and operates your computer that you do your computation and data storage increasingly on, is not insignificant, let's say. We should probably pay some attention to that as well. And so this is work in progress. These are very preliminary figures, but you know, we can calculate this sort of like a rough ratio of a given country's cloud infrastructure. To what extent is it US versus Chinese? The bars, each of the bars represents a country. The bars on the left are those countries whose cloud infrastructure is completely American, and countries on the right are ones whose cloud infrastructure is completely Chinese. And we can ask, well, you know, what determines this? How is this geography being shaped? And for instance, we can note that many of the countries on the left, like Finland, Sweden, Norway, they are NATO allies. So perhaps there's a sort of security bloc thing going on here. But then we can observe that there's some countries on the very right, such as Turkey, also a NATO ally, but completely Chinese infrastructure. Saudi Arabia, major non-NATO ally designated by US Congress, but still uses Chinese infrastructure. Well, perhaps the better explanation is then that countries that import more from China in general, they also import cloud. And so maybe I'm overthinking it by bringing in NATO and security politics, and maybe it's just business as usual. And that kind of an explanation seems to work pretty well. But then we have counterexamples. You have on the left side also Taiwan, which does far more trade with mainland China than with the US, yet all of the cloud infrastructure from Taiwan is from US, perhaps not coincidence. You have other examples. So we could then hypothesize based on that well, so governments use policies such as incoming investment screening to ensure that infrastructure investments are within their kind of national security interests, and that would go quite far in explaining this geography. But then you have other examples like Philippines, which is towards the right side. Philippines is locked in a territorial dispute with China over some islands in South China Sea, and this has escalated into a kinetic conflict. And at the same time, the Chinese government sponsored the construction of a very large Alibaba cloud data center in Manila, which is able to now offer very low-cost, low-latency infrastructure to the Philippines economy and society. Could there be some geopolitical angle into this? I don't know, but certainly that is a question that some people are now asking. So to sum up, basically, where is your computer actually? Who owns and operates it? What kinds of risks may that create? How can governments and companies manage those risks? Those are the kinds of questions that I and some other people are now labeling as the issue of digital economic security. And in my lab, we use a mix of computational data collection methods, of statistical modeling, as well as qualitative research based on international political economy to attempt to answer these questions. Thank you very much.